Thank you for the Holy Spirit that brings this love, this joy, and this peace. Lord, we worship you. Almighty God, we worship you. Lord, we worship you. Almighty God, we worship you. Thank you for this great love. Thank you for your joy unspeakable. Thank you, Father, for the peace that passes all understanding, brought into our lives by your Spirit. Lord, we yield to you. Lord, we worship you. Holy, holy is your name. Lord, we yield to you. Lord, we worship you. Oh, holy, holy, holy is your name. Lord, we yield to you. Lord, we worship you. Oh, holy, holy, holy is your name. Hallelujah. Lord, we worship you. Lord, we yield to you. Holy, holy, holy is your name. Father, we love you. Father, we love you. Lord, we adore you. Lord, we adore you. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy is your name. Father, we love you. Father, we love you. We adore you. Holy, 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 holy is your name. Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus, we love you. Hallelujah. We adore you. Oh, holy, holy, holy is your name. Thank you, mighty God. Lord Jesus, we love you. Lord, we adore you. Oh, holy, holy, holy is your name. Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, we love you. We adore you. Oh, holy, holy. Holy Spirit, we love you. We adore you, Jesus. Oh, holy, holy, holy. Hallelujah. 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 Father, we thank you. Lord Jesus, we thank you. Holy Spirit, we thank you. Oh, amazing God. Why don't you just let the Spirit of the Lord fill you with His goodness? Fill you with a great appreciation and thanksgiving for the things that, listen, you know what? Reality of it is,
is outside of Christ Jesus, there is no life. I mean, you're living being, but you're dead while you live. And what men have been taught from their birth is they've been taught how to delight in and enjoy things that really have very little to do with life. It's just a break from the agony. It's called joy. And so, you know, people think, well, that's an extreme view of life. Well, it's God's extreme view of life. And so I figure he's got a whole lot more wisdom than everybody that I know of. So I'm going to go with what he says, and I'm going to come to understand what it is that he has revealed to us through Christ Jesus. And reality of it is if you're willing, it becomes very plain. At first, you look at the problem, you look at the equation, you go, what on earth? Huh? Right? Are you with me?
Yes.
F of 1 equals X as X approaches infinity. The first time I saw that, I'm like, what are we supposed to do with this? For those of you who know, that's intro to calculus, right? What are we supposed to do with this program? You know? But after you stare at it for a while and think about it, right? And then some of you guys, you're amazing mathematicians. But for the rest of us, we looked at the problem for a long time before we started getting a clue as to what was going on. And some of us never got a clue. Father's come here to help us understand what life is all about and how to live it. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Well, listen, why don't you sit down? Let me teach you a few things about what I'm saying, okay? Can I do that?
Yeah.
You know, has anybody here, do you get a little frustrated with the fact that everybody walks around and basically with an attitude of hate and despite? Doesn't it get a little old? You know what I'm saying? Strife, murder, all the stuff that goes on, you know, kind of, you can really get a, you can get a bird's eye view of it just driving down I-5 or I-15 or just the basically daily interactions trying to get into a parking place at the shopping center and, you know, it turns into a war if you're not careful. And doesn't it get a little bit old, the argument, the fuss, the, you know, the continual ongoing problems and issues? Well, the reality of it is, that is the state and the spirit of the world. So if you don't like it so much, why then participate with it? I mean, if it's really, you know, I run into people all the time, tell me that they like dogs and horses a whole lot better than human beings. The reality of it is they just don't like themselves either, you know, unless they somehow have this exceptionalism thing going on where they believe that everybody else is like that, but they themselves aren't like that. The only way that we get to be delivered from the spirit of the world is through this wonderful work of divine grace, where Father made a way for you and I to no longer live under the tyranny of the demonic reign. And somebody says, well, is it really that bad? It really truly is that bad. The tyranny of the demonic reign teaches people how to hate each other instead of love each other, teaches people to think that dogs and horses are better than human beings. I mean, you know, Satan's big propaganda is to in every way eliminate the beauty and the splendor and the image and the glory of God that we were shaped in, that we were created in when Father came up with this amazing plan that he had. I think it's just an amazing plan that he would create man in his own image and in his own likeness. I just think this is amazing. And you should too, because you're a product of that right now. And so I don't know why you're not as happy as you, as far as I'm concerned, as you should be. Because if he didn't come up with a plan, I mean, that's, you know, it's just, the obvious would not be the result. And you and I sitting here looking like we look, I'm happy that I look like I look. Even with the wrinkles and the graying, I'm just happy that I look like what I look. And man, when man came into this world, man was born blind. And, you know, I want you to look at a gospel message here. I love studying the seven signs of the Gospel of John, which begins with Jesus turning the water into wine. And they're not just miracles. There's something above miracles. They're signs. They're the declarations of specific things about who Christ Jesus is and what it is that he came to do for us. And around every, of course, understand this, all the miracles, all the signs and wonders, all the things that Christ Jesus did, if they were all to be told, if they were all to be written about, the whole of the world could not contain the books. And so the things that we do have written concerning the life and ministry of Jesus, very, very important. Every word of it is essential. There's no redundancy there. There's no contradictions there. Men would try to take it. Theologians will try to take it. Reality theologians that really have no relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ at all, that have not been born of the Spirit. You know, if you want to get a grant from the United Bible Society, it's pretty easy, so long as you'll posture yourself to do research and you know, biblical studies. And a lot of theology just comes out of that. So it's not real theology at all. It's not people who are sincere about a relationship with the living God, earnest and hungry to know the things that Father's called us to understand in His Word. They're just charting their course of, you know, doing the things that whatever they're doing with all their ulterior motives. But for those of us who've been born of the Spirit and we're made alive from the dead, spiritually we've been made alive from the dead. Reality of it is, the contrast between the church and the world should be as radical as standing beside someone who's in a coffin versus someone who's up walking around. Unfortunately, that isn't what it looks like. We've been so integrated with the spirit of the world, it's all whacked out, it's all messed up. We give our children over literally to the spirit of the world to be taught how to function and operate and yield to demons and call it normal. And you know, when people hear me talk like this, they think, oh my goodness, this guy's a throwback to, the Dark Ages. You know, well, I go back further than the Dark Ages. You know, I go all the way back to Jesus. I'm like right here in the year of the Lord. This is the day that the Lord has made. This is the acceptable year of the Lord. I mean, I'm living in the day and I'm living in the year. I'm living in the generation of those who've been born again. I mean, Father doesn't have grandchildren. Everybody's his children, the direct impact of this wonderful work of divine power and grace. Hallelujah. God is so good. And the reality of it is, His Father wants us to know how wonderful life is and how wonderful human beings are that He created. I mean, I look at men and their wickedness and their hatred and their war and their variance and their strife and their thievery and their abuse and just wanting to take advantage of other men and all the things that greed does. Greed is a tyrant. And I think, God so loved the world. Here's men. Because we could immediately look at that and go, well, I'm moving to the country. You know, I'm getting out of here. I have nothing to do with these people. God so loved the world. Father, if there's anybody who could have said, I'm out of here, I'm not having anything to do with these people, it would have been God. And of course, you know, man in the first 1,565 years of their existence, which is really covers up to Genesis chapter 6, had become so wicked. In 1,565 years, there was a different kind of restraint put upon the powers of darkness in the satanic realm. Obviously, because we've been over 4,000 years now, and we've not gotten to the state that they had gotten to in the first 1,565 years, where God said that it grieves me, I repent that I've even made man. They're doing things it never entered in my mind that they would ever do this. That in 1,565 years, men yielding to the spirit of the world had become so much like the devil that God could not recognize them. He saw nothing about His image and His glory there. They had so corrupted their ways that the meditations of their heart, the way that they thought, the way that they processed, the way that they lived out their life was only evil and wicked continually. God in His mercy said, I'm going to bring an end to it. God in His mercy. And His judgments is always expressing His mercy. His mercy rejoices over His judgment, but His judgment is always expressing His mercy. Because to leave it as it was, there was no hope for humanity. There was none. So God in His mercy saves one family. There's one family. I mean, you think about the statistics there. Because on the earth in 1,565 years, with people living as old as they were living, it was a huge population, greater than, you know, potentially greater than it is even right now. It was a huge number of people. Exponential growth rates are incredible to look at, going back to the whole subject of man. Think about it. There's one family. There's one family who's not messed up with all of this stuff. There's one family, there's one group of people. There was one Enoch who was this radical, crazy guy talking about God's coming with His judgment to execute His judgment upon all the ungodliness for all the ungodly deeds which they ungodly commit. They're like, this is the weird guy. He's the throwback to the first, you know, first day of creation. I don't know what they said then. I mean, don't you understand? We're living in the 1565th year of creation. Things have advanced now. We're not still back there in the Garden of Eden. I don't know how they taught, you know, how they processed it or how they taught it or how they spoke it, but men are the same. No matter where you find them, they're the same. If you go to the 88th parallel in the Northwest Territory, or you go to the outback of Australia, or you go to, you know, the New Zealand, wherever you go to the jungles of the Congo, you go to Indonesia, Irian Jaya, Papua New Guinea, people are the same. They just look a little different. They do the same, they act the same. You know, it was a funny thing when we were up in the Northwest Territory, and we watched these little, you know, Inuit kids. They'd take the gum, pull it out of their mouth, swing it around their finger, pop it back in their mouth. Okay? No TVs, nothing, okay? We go to the outback and the Pitjantjaras of Australia, watch the exact same thing done by a little Aborigine. They take the gum, pull it out, swing it around their finger, pop it in their mouth. They had no television. There was no way to communicate from the Inuits of the 88th parallel and the Aborigines of Pitjantjara. No way. They just acting the same. Humanity. It is amazing. Down to the very little details of the way the kids play with their gum in their mouth. It's amazing when we begin to think about, you know, the reality of this place that we are all in and connected with, and the distinction that God wants to make when He comes and brings to us the revelation of His love for us, that brings a complete transformation, not an excuse to continue to act all hateful and everything. Not an excuse to continue to act all sad and sorrowful and, oh, we're just going through the same sets of problems. I'm not going through the same sets of problems of the world as the world is going through. I'm not dealing with that. Huh? My problem is whacking the powers of darkness everywhere that I can find them. My issues is being at war against everything that Satan would try to throw at me to stand in this wonderful divine power and grace to you know, worship Father and praise Him and thank Him for this transformation of life. I'm not looking to be like the world. I'm daily captivated by the privilege of being conformed to the image of Christ Jesus. That's beautiful. And you know, if you really dislike all of the hatred and all of the mess and the thievery and all the greed and stuff, then reality of it is you should be repulsed by it. You should refuse to allow any of it in your life, and have this, now that you have this opportunity to step into relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ and be taught every day by God. Instead of being taught how to be like the devil every day, you get to be taught how to be like God every day.
Hallelujah.
What a wonderful, is that amazing or what? I mean, in 1565 years, men had become so wicked that they were unrecognizable by God. They were born in sin. They were shaped in iniquity. They were born blind. They were born absolutely spiritually blind. And this is how every human being today is born in the same condition. Every person sitting in this room right now, watching me by the web, or YouTube, or FaceStream, were born completely blind. All you had with respect to the realms of life and truth and interaction with God, you were groping at things, trying to figure out what it looks like, trying to depend at best upon your feeling, your touch, your smell, your taste, and your hearing. There was no real perception of what life is all about. And here, the Lord Jesus in John chapter 9 comes and He sees a man born blind. First thing that, you know, the disciples, which should know better by this time, first thing they want to do is they want to talk about the theological situation of the guy. Right. It's like there's no connectivity to his plight, to his situation. They just want to talk about whether he, and this is a crazy concept, whether he sinned. Well, no, wait, stop a minute. He's born blind, man. Okay, this is going deep. Okay, this is going really deep. He's born blind. Now they want to talk about whether or not he sinned. Well, what opportunity he's got to sin as an embryo is a really unique concept to debate. Or whether it was his parents that sinned. My goodness, Jesus is not even anywhere near that. No. He's not anywhere even near that. All he's thinking about is, I'm the light of the world. I've come into the world that those who are blind may see. Amen. All he's concerned about is the dire straits that this guy is in, the pathetic situation that he's in, as he sits there begging for a living, born blind. And he says, it has nothing to do with either one. Right. And now here's where people want to start basically taking up where the disciples left off and go into some other crazy deep ideology and theology. But so that, he says, but so that the glory of God may be revealed, the glory of God may be manifested. As though that now we're going to take that and say, oh, well, the Lord is saying that he was born blind, so, and he, you know, you got to go through this sickness and this sorrow, and God's going to put him through all this agony and suffering so that one day the glory of God could be revealed in him. Jesus is not saying that. He's saying, for neither cause was, not for his sin or his parents' sin, Jesus has come to interface with a sin-cursed world that is overrun by destruction and death and sickness and disease, and he says, and iniquity. And he said, I've come to the world to destroy the powers of darkness and liberate men. And that's what he's saying. Hello. Do you? And the question is always coming to you and I, do you want to be delivered? Well, you want to be delivered up to the point of that which you enjoy. Or you want to be delivered up to the point of that which you think is good. Because we're trying to parse things out and perceive them on our own basis. We like integration with the world, which Jesus Christ described as being everything that was opposed to him. And the gospel that he preached, because he preached the radical gospel. Jesus preached the radical gospel. His gospel was, you either are for me or you against me. If you're for me, you're going to follow me. You're going to do exactly what I do. This is Jesus. People don't want extremes. They don't want absolutes, because every day they've been taught in a, you know, Greco-Roman society that absolutes are, you know, are meaningless, and they want to make everything. It's a move towards nihilism, to where everything is okay. A nihilistic concept of philosophy, all these things that go that date back to Aristotle and before. And now we want to have some, a little bit of Holy Ghost, a little bit of Aristotle, a little bit of Jesus, a little bit of Plato. Huh? Are you with me? A little bit of what Father says, a little bit of what Socrates has to say. We want to blend all these things together, and then we want to have relativism to describe, you know, what we should be doing, what we shouldn't be doing, what's right, what's wrong. No, this isn't the way things are supposed to be going. God has given to us His Word, to show us and to describe to us what is right and what's wrong, what is evil and what is good. And what is evil and what is good goes way beyond just the macro perception of somebody killing somebody versus somebody living in peace. You know, both could be evil. Both could be evil. There's one that's going to come called the Antichrist, who's going to come and he's going to propagate peace and he's going to look good, but he's absolutely the most evil and most wicked man that has ever lived. There's absolutely no way that you and I can, by relativisms and by the ideas and the concepts of propagated in a world that we call normal and fashionable and the things that we identify as right, can ever measure up to the reality of the lie of what God has given to us and what He has defined as good and what is evil. And He says the only way we're ever going to get it is to have our senses exercised by use of His Word. The only way we're going to ever get that is to allow the Spirit of Truth to show us the contrast. And then somebody's got to be willing to say, wait a minute, I'm going to stop yielding my members to iniquity. I'm going to stop with the compromises. I'm going to stop living in my own human frame of reference, deciding what is good for me and what's bad for me and what I believe and what I don't believe, what I agree with and what I disagree with. And this is the tension that you're living in. And Father wants to lead you by the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
He wants to teach you His Word. And you're going to have to be willing to be good students. And He's going to tell you, have nothing to do with the world, all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust in the eye. The pride of life is not of the Father. It's not on the inside of you if you've been born of God. Amen. If you've been born of His love, it's not on the inside of you. It's outside of you trying to get into you. And you're going to have to understand that these fleshly lusts war against your soul. And you're going to have to understand that that compromise is the devil's game. There's people from the pulpit who teach whole series of sermons on the value of compromise. Compromise is the devil's game. That's all he needs is a little bit of compromise. He'll take you all the way he wants. He'll take you to the ultimate place of iniquity. Because the reality of it is the whole message from Genesis 1 to Revelation 22, 21 is to describe to us how the little bit, just a little bit of sin, where men decide to disobey God. Now, we know that from Genesis chapter 3, verse 4, they desire to be gods. So that's a little bit more than just a little bit. But the act of disobedience that led them into that place that, listen, if you participate with this program, if you partake of that knowledge of good and evil, you will be like gods. That's the real temptation there. That's where it's all at. But that little bit of disobedience ultimately results in that little compromise, what seemed to be a little compromise with a big ambition, ultimately ends by the time that you get to the book of Revelation where men want to do away with God altogether. They don't want him around. He's going to be easily qualified within relativism and humanism as a monster because he is going to destroy the wicked. He's going to destroy the wicked, and he's going to parse wicked all the way down to you telling a lie. Amen. That, oh, it wasn't so bad. No, he's going to be turned into this monster who will not allow any adulterer, any fornicator, any person belonging and attached to anything that the spirit of the world has to give an offer, that demon spirits develop, homosexuality, you name it. He will destroy them. Pretty radical. Pretty radical. So where's the compromise with humanism and relativism and the ideas of man's not so bad after all and always condoning something? Oh, it seems harmless. Well, all sin seems harmless. Eating of the fruit seems harmless. It's just fruit. Look, it's good. Looks good. Pleasant to the eye. It's desired because it's going to make us wise. I mean, where would God have any problem with us becoming wise? Come on, let's rationalize this. Let's rationalize our sin. Let's rationalize our iniquity. Let's rationalize our disobedience. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
I hope you are. Because these things are being imposed upon you on a level that's going to get a whole lot worse.
True.
They're going to get a whole lot worse. Somebody said, oh, you know, the church, you know, they just think that the rapture is going to take place. You know, the church is going to come to a place where they're praying for the catching away to take place. It's going to get a whole lot worse than it is now. I promise you. It's going to get a whole lot worse than it is right now. And the issue is, how many compromises are you going to make with each succeeding generation? At what point are we going to finally say, well, here we make our stand and we're compromising no more. Here we're consecrated to God and we're not going to give in anymore. We're not, you know, we followed you in our dress. We followed you in our activity. We followed you in all of the various different, you know, your pursuits for pleasure and entertainment, but we're not going to go any further. Reality of it is that place, that end point will never ultimately be found, because one compromise would inevitably lead to another compromise. God stepped into the world so that you and I would no longer be blind, walking in relativism, walking in these various different compromises, trying to rationalize and justify our existence and the sense of the things that we feel like that, you know, it's just impossible for us to do. Let me give you one. Be holy, God says, even as I am holy. Well, do you realize how holy God is? Hello. Stop. Be holy even as I'm holy. And this is what God commands. Be holy even as I'm holy. You know how holy he is. He's so holy that the seraphims have been worshiping him for how many eons? Are you with me? And they still can't look at him. They try to look at it, it's just like, ah! He's holy. And it's excitement, it's ecstasy. It's a joy, it's a pleasure that men know nothing about. All they know is men have their pleasures are designed. Listen to this. This is pretty wild now. Hang on. Fasten your seatbelt. Men's pleasures are designed around watching demons destroy other human beings. Pornography. Just give that one, because it's huge right now. I mean, not looking at the statistics of how many people are involved in that. It's through the roof. Christians. And they've got ways, you know. People, I'm going to tell you right now, I told everybody one time, I said, listen, guys, I've got an app. It's a special app. It shows me everywhere all of you are going online. And people's eyes get really big. Pastor knows. Yeah. It's called the Word of Knowledge. I didn't actually create the app. But, you know, I want to create an app called Total Transparency, and everybody voluntarily participates, and it tracks everywhere that you go electronically, and there's a readout.
There you go.
Huh? Think about it. Come on, people. Listen to me. You know, and men get their pleasure out of watching demon spirits destroy other human beings. And the list of it goes on and on and on. There would be no fornication if men weren't getting their pleasure out of watching demons destroy other human beings. There would be no children being aborted. And the list goes on. Everything that goes on within the framework of sin is primarily that man gratifying his lust at the expense of someone else. That's sin. That's what men call life. I'm so glad God delivered me. I want nothing to do with it. And the more time you spend around him, soaking in his presence, being overwhelmed with his love and his joy, the more you want nothing to do with the things in the spirit of this world. I mean, you get so baptized in the realms of the fire of the Holy Ghost, Satan burned his fingers trying to touch you. You become so fortified, every missile that he launches bounces off of you. People are so fixated on sin and looking at what they're not supposed to do, rather than being captivated with righteousness and all the privileges that God has now allowed us to enjoy. I mean, if we turn this thing around, I mean, think about Adam and Eve. They're looking, they got this garden. And there's just, in the garden, there is this plenteous thing that God has done where there's so millions of different trees with all different kinds of fruits, all different kinds. Everything is free and open to them to do it. And they're looking at one thing that they're not supposed to do. They're fixated on one thing. It's pretty crazy, isn't it? And they weren't there long. Somebody said, how do you know? Because God said, be fruitful and multiply. And when God blesses the womb like that, I promise you. Huh? Are you listening to me? It doesn't take a month. It doesn't necessar. Are you listening? He went there long. And it's just things that's completely just overturned. It's so sad. And you live in the same choices right now, at this moment. You're making the same choices. You're making the same choices. Whether you're going to obey God's word and follow him, or whether there's going to be compromises, where are you going to go with things that are unholy. Whether you're going to live in a place of relativism, or whether you're going to say, listen, here's what the Lord's done. He's opened up my eyes. He's given me this privilege to be born again, to be made a new creation, to have a new heart, have a new desire, new passions, new emotions. He's written his word upon my heart and upon my mind so that I'm a living epistle, to be read of men, to be something distinct and unique from all others, to be as the light of the world, a city set upon the hill that cannot be hid, a contrast between life and death, between light and darkness, between truth and lie. And yet you see such an intermingling of that. Men have, if you want to learn how to have your facial muscles basically be fixed in a joy position, you've got to practice that. People got joy atrophy. And those muscles are atrophied. Huh? They're all, if you want to learn how to walk in his love, you've got to yield your members to it. God, the Holy Spirit, has set us free, brought us into the realms from hate to love. Amen. That extreme. Yes. Somebody said, no. You always, listen, then why is the divorce rate so high? Then why is the abortion rate so high? Then why is every variable that you can monitor within humanity so high on the wrong scale? I said to a person the other day, I said, wouldn't you want to be happy all the time? And they said, yes. I said, see, you're not in control of your life. Then they backpedaled, said, no. I wouldn't want to be happy all the time. I need a little sadness so I can be more happy about my gladness. And it's ridiculous. I said, you are on the right track. You were being honest before you realized I painted you into a corner. There is none so blind as those who refuse to see. Jesus comes as the light of the world to minister his goodness. And there's a bunch of Pharisees and a bunch of religious people and a bunch of secular people and a bunch of people who want to have it their way. And it doesn't matter how big the miracle, how big the sign, how big the wonder. It doesn't matter if God the Father himself steps down out of heaven and everybody sees him literally sitting upon a cloud, that he steps upon the ground and begins to declare his word, they will be of the same state still. Take a man who loves unrighteousness and put him in the land of the upright, and he will still do wickedly. That's just what God's judgments are. He says, this is it. He's, you know, his discourse with the rich man. Oh, let Lazarus, the guy that I always thought, you know, less of, and had no time to even, you know, help him out on any scale, even to toss him a crumb of bread or anything. Let him raise him from the dead. Let him come to life again and go tell my brothers. Jesus says no. I mean, forgive me. Father says no. And of course, in the story, he is, you know, typified by Abraham. He says no. He said they have Moses and the prophets. They have the law and the prophets. They have the Bible. They have my word. And if they won't believe that, neither will they believe if someone's raised from the dead. Here we are, people. You have God's word today. Huh? So what's wrong with it? Let's just go do a little yoga. Well, do you know where the yoga came from? I'm gonna start meddling now. I'm going to go after it. Your little dance school. Do you know where your little dance school came from? I'm going to teach your girls how to be like the mother of harlots, to yield to a Jezebel spirit. Dance, song, sacred. It belongs to worship. We say, Lord, we love you, and holy, holy, holy is your name. But yet we got all these compromises because it's harmless. It's harmless. And the little witches and warlocks and all the little demons at Disneyland, harmless. Oh, it's harmless. Yeah, sure, it's harmless. Now you're wondering why your children turned out the way they did. Because you all upset because the pastor, the preacher said, the Enoch kind of preacher said it's ungodly. The Enoch kind of preacher says you cannot have any converse or participation or fellowship with the world. Anyone who is friendly with the world, likes the world, is the enemy of God and will be destroyed. Ah, God's not a monster. No, he's not. And he hates iniquity and sin. And he in his love and grace moved with his compassion and mercy to come into a sin-torn world, a sin-cursed world, and make a way of escape. Amen. For anybody who's willing. Amen. Anybody, that Jesus isn't an excuse and a provision provided for sinners. He's a way of escape for those who don't want to be involved in it anymore. Jesus doesn't matter to people who want to continue to live in the spirit of this world. He doesn't matter. He does. It's of no consequence. Because all that is making a religion out of Jesus. You can't deny him, so now you got to make a religion out of him. He's too powerful. His influence too great to say he doesn't exist. So somehow you're gonna have to make room for some part of this person, Jesus, in your life. And so now he's a religion. Hell's harder for the people who knew better and didn't do it. Because it's just always there before you. Jesus, so radical, said, you got any compromises, any sin, anything to do with the spirit of this world going on in your life? He said, pluck out your eye. What? Can you imagine? The Church of the Redeemed, those are the one-eyed. The one-eyed Church of the Redeemed. Jesus is radical. Ah, it's a hyperbole. No, hyperbole is a theological way to say that God lied. Okay, let me back out a little bit. A hyperbole is a way to say that Jesus or God exaggerated. Personally, if you really, really sincerely and honestly parse that out, an exaggeration is a lie. Is a lie. God has no hyperboles. No. It isn't a biblical word. Amen. He said, if your hand offends you, and he's just talking about doing something wrong relationally, treating someone wrong. Because when it comes to the end of the analysis, the Lord's going to hold us on account of how well we loved each other. And when there is love going on, there is no sin there. You're not gonna be up participating with demon spirits, destroying somebody else and get some pleasure out of it. If your hands cut him off, the one-handed Church of the Redeemed. You just don't really. This Jesus is radical about it. God said, be holy even as I am holy. Amen. People feel threatened by it. And then just feel so threatened about it, they got to come up with some kind of theological explanation to explain it away. It's never to incorporate it. It's to explain it away. The Lord empowered us.
Amen.
He empowered us. Amen. He empowered us. He said, you are born in sin and shaped in iniquity, but now I've given the privilege for you to be born in righteousness and every day shaped in holiness. I've given you the opportunity to be able to grow in grace, to desire the sincere nourishment of the Word of God, so that that Word of God that you were born by, listen, think about it. The Word of God, His, the expression of His thoughts, the person that He is, brought to us a new birth through the expressions of the desires of His heart and of His thinking, so that we would be like Him, act like Him, think like Him, talk like Him in His image and in His likeness. True. That's full time. That's coming out from among them, being separate, says the Lord. Touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. This was not a verse of scripture in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 17 and 18, for the Amish. Or the Mennonites. I was watching the Mennonites the other day playing soccer. It's so cute. They got their little bonnets on, their dresses are all the way down to their ankles, and they're running around. Because their dress, you know, is confining them. Bless their darling hearts. Praise God for somebody who's got some kind of, you know, they're going to freeze it. The compromise is somewhere. They froze it. They froze the compromises at a point. It says, no. We want to move forward, not backwards. He said, oh, we're advancing. You're not advancing. You're going backwards. God's advancing. Father's in the future. He's empowered us to be holy as He is holy.
Amen.
He baptized us in His Holy Spirit and fire. Amen. After giving us a new birth, and His Spirit came at the new birth. When you're born again and you receive a new heart and you receive a new spirit. Huh? At that moment in time, God, the Holy Spirit, comes to live in us. We become one with Him. And then the Lord, that is to live the life of Jesus. We receive a new, or become a new creature to live the life of Jesus. People want to make Jesus into a religion that has nothing to do about living His life. And so I'm trying to be better. You're trying. Your efforts are futile. It's the arm of flesh, and cursed is every man who trusts in the arm of flesh. God has given to us His Holy Spirit in the new birth, that we might live the life of Jesus. And then He takes it another place and another step. There in the new birth, we are given the privilege and the power to live the life of Jesus and the authority to be sons of God, but He takes it to another step. He baptizes us in the Holy Ghost and fire so that we can now do the ministry of Jesus. And He doesn't want any... And somebody said, well, I don't believe I need to go that far. You get the life of Jesus, you want to do the ministry of Jesus. Because heaven's good all the way around. Huh? The privilege of being able to not hand somebody a couple of aspirins for their headaches, but to tell the demon spirit to leave? The harassing, tormenting thing? Oh, no, it's physiological, Pastor. Don't you understand that we know more about neurology today than we did before? And we understand how the neurological system integrates with the endocrine system and how the biochemistry is at the heart of it. We understand the complete, you know, cascades of and feedback and loop back and upstream and downstream mechanisms that are involved. No, you don't. And notice anyone else. Because it's more spiritual than it is, you know, sodium and potassium flowing back and forth between cells. Huh? If you believe that, we got some swamp land. It's just an invested kind of thing. No, it's, come on, y'all. Come on now. All these things that we want to try to, you know, by and large, there's things that science does get a clue about. They just stumble on. It's all serendipity. It means discovery by accident. Huh? It's true. You got to fiddling around and find out, hey, you pushed the button. You said, you know, something went off. And you're like, wow, we just discovered something. No, you didn't. You just accidentally stumbled on something. The reality of it is, to be without God, we're just lost and we're blind and we're in darkness and we don't know whether we're coming or whether we're going. We don't know anything about life. He that has, possesses Christ Jesus, has life.
Amen.
He that has the Son possesses Christ Jesus, has Him living on the inside of them. And He's got to be more than deep down in your heart. He's got to be expressed through the conduct and your actions. I mean, as you know, Peter said, seeing as you've been given the divine nature and you've escaped the corruption that's in the world through lust, seeing as you've been given this privilege, this grace, this mercy, he said, give all diligence to making your calling and election sure. You should spend all day practicing not only moving in faith, but moving in excellence of character and purity. This is what he says. I mean, think about it. Did you wake up this morning saying, today I'm going to be better at excellence of character and purity than ever before? Give yourself to self-control, practicing excellence and self-control in knowledge, in brotherly kindness, in godliness, in this divine activity of love and walking in humility and brokenness. He says, because if you do these things, you'll never stumble. If you don't do these things, you're blind and can't see it far off. In other words, he says you're extremely nearsighted. Like this. You got to read like this. I think that's a D. You forgot that you were purged from your old sins. You were purged from the former bondage that you lived in. Why now being delivered? Why now being able to see all the heavenly realm? Would you then go back to the realms of hell and the demonic? The Lord has made an opportunity for you and I to live and interact with all that belongs to heaven right now. We're seated with Him in the heavenly realm. Christ the King lives on the inside of me. God the Holy Ghost lives on the inside of me. I'm the temple of the Most High. Think about it over here, people. Think about it. Listen to me. We house in God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. And you don't, and God understands that somehow you're going to still diddle-dally around with rebellion and stubbornness. You know, there is only one thing that Christ Jesus cannot cure. Only one. And that was displayed by the Pharisees in their self-reliance, in their pride, in their arrogance, in their self-exaltation, that they're right and they would not be convinced of anything else no matter what happened. We talk to people all the time. We lay out the Word of God, which is the most powerful thing on earth. The Word of God framed the heavens, and yet they still are wanting, or they're still willing to stay within the framework of what they think and what they imagine, rather than allowing the Word in every way to change how you process the world around you, how you see things. The Word of God brings to us heaven's perspective and gives to us the ability to decide on things according to what Father has willed. And we say, Father, Your will be done. Really? As they say in Japan, oh, really? Father, Your will be done. I want Your will be done. He says, okay, and that is, understand, that is really the issue. From Matthew 7:21 to 1 John chapter 3, verse 17. From Matthew 7:21, where he said, you did not do the will of the Father. Depart. I don't know you. And it's an eternal damnation to go into an eternal torture chamber. Oh, God's a monster. No, He's not. He hates iniquity and He hates sin. And He paid the highest price possible for you and I to be able to escape it. And He's provided for us everything that we need to live the heavenly life. And all that's being sorted out is who wants to live in heaven, who wants to live in hell. All is being sorted out is who wants to follow God and who wants to follow Satan. All is being sorted out is who wants to walk in the spirit of holiness and who wants to walk in a demonic spirit. That's all that's being sorted out. It's being sorted out in our lives every single day. Every single day, we are tempted to join league with our appetites, our attitudes, our emotions, and our passion with demon spirits. And Father has given us the divine power and ability to simply say no, but he's going to engage with all heaven's power and authority at the response of our own will, to where we say no. And when we say no, He engages with all heaven's authority to stop everything Satan was trying to do to destroy you. If we say yes to Him, He engages with all heaven's authority to empower us so that we can be holy even as He's holy. Because it's a gift. It's a gift. Here, I'm going to give you a gift. I give you the gift of My own holiness that the seraphims haven't even been able to stare at for the past trillion years. I give you the gift of my likeness. I give you the gift of my power. I give you the gift of my splendor. I give you the gift of my nature. I give you the gift of my beauty. I give you the gift of my excellence. Reality of it is, people, is every single day ought to be about you preparing for your meeting with Almighty God. Because He's not going to judge you on based on relativism. Father, I wasn't as bad as the rest of the folks in my neighborhood. Or whatever else it is that people come up with to justify their wrongdoing. Lord, you understood that I did not have the strength or the ability, that sin was greater. That Adam's disobedience had more an effect upon me than Jesus' righteousness and Jesus' obedience. You're going to tell me that Adam's disobedience is more powerful to influence you spiritually than God incarnated in flesh, Christ Jesus' obedience. That's nonsense. That's nonsense. And you know, Paul lays that to rest in Romans chapter 5. All that stuff. You're going to tell me that somehow the influence of demon spirits are stronger and more effective than the influence of the Holy Ghost? Give me a break. They're not even in the same league. It's not even in the same league. Are you listening to me? Yes. Not even in the same league. Amen. We're going to have to get on the side of right and recognize that we confess with our heart. We confess with our mouth and believe in our heart this wonderful work of salvation. With our mouth we confess that we are saved. And with our heart we believe unto unrighteousness. That we all unrighteous. Paul's discourse in Romans chapter 3, verse 10 through verse 14 is a declaration of this is the state of men. Right. Their mouth is an open sepulcher. Talk about bad breath. Right. I mean, every thought, every behavior, every attitude of humanity is wicked. That's what Romans 3:10 through 14 is about. Isn't it a description of the redeemed? That many of you want to make that a description of the redeemed, that we're all unrighteous. Give me a break. That's a lie from right out of hell to strip you of all your identity and all of your authority and all the goodness of God brought to us when He made us alive from the dead. Guess what? You're not going to get this on your own. You're going to have to come to a place of submitting yourself to God the Holy Ghost and submitting yourself to the authority that He placed in the church. And boy, has Satan ever conned. After that, just in the past 20 years, the authority in the church. And he does it by past 30 years, by, you know, setting things up to where leaders in the church abuse their power and everybody then runs, you know, away saying, you know, I'm not putting my trust there or whatever. Listen, God placed in His church the most beautiful, wonderful things that exist. He did. In His church, He put apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. In His church, He made a way for you and I to be made perfect. Amen. To mature, to grow, to be built up, to be strengthened. In the midst of His church is gifts of healing. Right here. People go sit for hours. Think about the man at the pool of Bethesda. Bless his heart. All he had was a hope that an angel once a year would come down and stir the waters and he could get in first. Can't you just see him just trying to crawl over? The angel's moving the waters. He's just about got his finger in and somebody comes in just ahead of him. This guy was so pathetic, nobody would help him. Jesus asked him about his situation and he's hoping, man, finally, maybe I got somebody to help me. He says, you know, when the angel stirs the water, I have no man. No one to help me. Pathetic situation. Somebody said, why did he just go to one man in the pool of Bethesda when there was a great multitude? He was the key to get all the rest of them out of there too. Because if that guy could get healed after laying there for 38 years, are you listening to me? Yes. Hallelujah. Yeah. We always want to make an excuse for why our situation is okay with God. Why my sickness and my disease is okay with God. Why my sin and my iniquity is okay with God. So we just take all of His word and everywhere we can possibly find it, we bend it to our rule. And wonder why we don't have faith. Faith comes on the authority of His word when we believe it and agree with it. And we say, no, I don't care how long I've had to deal with this thing. I know that my Redeemer has come. I know my Deliverer is here. It's not going to be a dominant power in my life. I believe with my heart unto righteousness because I've been given a gift of righteousness. So I'm righteous just as He's righteous. Some people think that it's a threat. When God says, you know, glorify me in your body and your spirit, they're mine. People think that's a threat. That's not a threat. It's an empowerment. Be pure, even as I am pure. I mean, come on. How pure is he? Every man that has his hope purifies himself just like he's pure. How are you going to do that? They say, no, I'm not having anything to do with iniquity. I'm not yielding my members to hate. A yells from hell, shout to the Lord. I'm going to start shouting praises instead of yelling, you know, accusations and threats. The reality of it is that we've lost a practical application. There's not been a bridge from the things that God has made available to us in our everyday existence. And that's got to change. You need to become a disciple of the Almighty God, because reality of it is effectiveness in the church is not only to reach them. That's not it. It's reach them, teach them, and send them. But the fact of it is many people sit in the church right now and they're not willing to be taught. And they're not willing to be sent. They don't have a proper goal set before them. They don't have a proper vision of their life of how do I get there? This is what I want to do. Rather, they're thinking about how they're going to make more money and how their career is going to be advanced and how many more toys. Look, the person with the most toys doesn't win. The person with the most money in the bank account when they die isn't the one that's acceptable to the Lord. I've heard all these people going to make all this wealth for the kingdom. All that is a distraction. It's a lie. God doesn't want that anyways. Huh? He makes rich and adds no sorrow with it. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. He empowers us. He empowers us with the ability in every area, spiritually, physically, materially. We just got to learn how to recognize that we need to agree with them. That we need to properly position ourselves in obedience to them to say, Lord, lead me. Lead on. I'm following you. Jesus takes spit, dirt, makes mud, sticks it in the eyes of the blind man, a man born blind, testifying that every human being is born blind when they come into this world. You're born blind. The spirit of this world, the God of this world, has blinded your eyes. 1 Corinthians 4:4. That's a threat. That's a threat that doesn't go away. And every place that you refuse truth, you accept lie. And every place that you refuse the revelation of God, you accept deception. That's right. And this thing's going on all the time. This thing's going on all the time. Huh? Are you listening to me? Yes. I pray in the name of Jesus that every power of darkness that has blinded you would be broken this day. Yes. That you would be able to clearly see the beauty and the splendor of the heavenly. Be so captivated with Jesus, so captivated with who he is and what it is he's doing that you want to do it too. Peter couldn't stay in the boat when he saw Jesus come in that dimension of the heavenly. He's like, listen, this wind and these waves were against me and they were threatening me and they were just a few minutes ago, I thought I was in peril for my life, but now I want to be out there walking with you, subduing everything that was a threat against me. I want to be out there in the heavenly realm with you, master over everything that is physical, everything that would be set against me, that would keep me from fulfilling your divine commission to go to the other side, to do what you said. And look, people, there can't be any half measures here. No half measures. The Lord didn't kind of make you a new creation. Are you listening to me? He made you a brand new being. Amen. The new birth is a spiritual moment of existence, just as you came forth from your mother's womb. Yeah. To give anything less than our all to that which he's purchased for us. It's just a testimony of unbelief. It's a testimony of disobedience. And we want to get that fixed. And we want to get that worked out real quickly. How? As I was saying, just because I want to finish it. The man, he recognized, he had faith. He had more faith in an angel that came and stirred the water once a year than the majority of Christians have today in Christ Jesus who stands in the midst of his church with the gifts of healing and miracles. Because the Lord has done it. He said it. In the church, he put the gift of miracles, the gift of healing. It's in the church. Christ Jesus stands in the midst of the church. He's same yesterday, today, and forever. He's made it absolutely proof, certain, absolute that this is true with many infallible witnesses. But no, can you imagine what would happen? What would happen if God's people have sickness and diseases and failures and faults and shortcomings and the things that they've allowed demonic powers to influence them and they become stronghold? If they just came in late in the meeting, they just came late in the church service, they just came late in the church, 24 hours a day. That's what that man was doing. He didn't just come there for the daytime and somebody took him home. He lived there. He was camped out at the Pool of Bethesda. I come from a long line of revivalists. My name is synonymous with Great Awakening. My genealogy is synonymous with Great Awakening. I understand why the revival services used to go 12 weeks to even 6 months. Somebody said, where were you born? Caney, Kansas. Oh, you're from Kansas. Caney, Kansas. No, it was a 12-week revival. It was meetings 2 and 3 times a day. Somebody says, well, how can you possibly do that and get to work? It works out. It works out. It all works out. Where the meetings are so good, you'll take your vacation time to be in them. What? That's weird, man. You're going to tell me you go to the church rather than go to the Alps? You got to be kidding me. You guys have completely gone off the deep end. No, you're just blind and you've not seen heaven. You've not seen the realms of glory. You've not been willing to recognize that God wants to train your senses for which is the unseen realm that will ultimately, if you allow him to train you, become visible. Ask Elisha to become visible. Were you so moved with the word of God and the faith of God, as Elisha said, take the 100 loaves of bread, take the 20 loaves of bread, set it before the 100 men, they'll be filled up to the full. Jesus takes it to a whole nother level and takes a few loaves and 2 small fishes and feeds more than 20,000 people. This is the realms of living in heaven. But we pray and nothing happened, and so now we are going to rewrite, you know, the plan of God and what we believe and what we think. Not me. He'll be my Savior until I die. He'll be my physician until I die. He'll be my insurance provider until I die. He'll be my attorney until I die. And then I'll just go into a whole other realm of him being my Savior. Hallelujah. My physician, he is the great physician. You know, Jesus told the blind man, he says, go wash in the pool of Siloam. If you go back to Isaiah chapter 8, you'll find out that they refused the gentle healing waters of Siloam, that they might go after their gods. There was only one blind man in all of Israel willing to go wash in the pool of Siloam. Siloam is where they would go, and they, on the Feast of Tabernacles, they would draw water and bring it up to the temple, saying, with joy shall we draw water from the wells of salvation, Isaiah chapter 12, verse 3. Speaking of the coming of the Holy Ghost and the outpouring of the Spirit of the living God through the lives of mortal men, the reign of the Messiah, and their concept of the Messiah was far less than what it is. The Messiah is far more than just a great ruler and king. He's God made flesh. They had no idea. There was only just a couple of little verses of scripture to hint that God would be made flesh by the prophets. The Lord kept it a mystery. A virgin shall encompass a man. A mystery. Your seed shall crush his head. A mystery. It was veiled in such mystery. This wonderful great coming of the Redeemer. God manifested in flesh, whose goings are from everlasting to everlasting. The messenger that should suddenly come to the temple. What does that mean? His name shall be Counselor, Mighty God, Prince of Peace, the Everlasting Father. Just 6, 7, 8 verses of Scripture. Out of all of the multitudes of the things that God said, just veiled of this coming incarnation, God made flesh. To go back before Christ Jesus and begin to distill this out to say, wait a minute, God is the Messiah. He would be incarnated in flesh, born of a virgin. That just wasn't happening. They just understood that the Messiah, the Redeemer, would come from Bethlehem, Ephrathah, among the people of Judea, that he would be a son of David. They had no idea he'd be the Son of God. No clue. And here we have been given this revelation. Now, what are we going to do with it? The veil has been rent in two, and we've been allowed to come into the holies of holies, and we're going to have to start seizing the moment of opportunity. We're going to have to start recognizing, wait, Father wants us to represent heaven with every sign and wonder and miracle and display of his power, as well as his character, his nature, his divine disposition. They can't be separated from each other. What happens when all of a sudden you just learn to sit in your living room, overwhelmed and captivated by the peace that passes understanding? Just, and the TV's off, and the radio's off, and you don't have any incense burning. There's no CD playing, and you're just captivated by the presence of God, and they're being taught by the Father how to see that the heavens are filled with the chariot of the Lord and the horsemen thereof. The prophet's servant went to a whole other realm of faith when revelation was there. All you got to do is be able to see. All you got to do is be able to see. The Lord, that's why Paul said, I pray continually that the spirit of wisdom and revelation will become yours, that it will be yours. That God will grant it to you, give it to you. And he wants to. He's just looking for some people who are going to take the sacred things and be responsible with it. He's already given us so many sacred things that perhaps we're profaning. And I pray in the name of Jesus, you'll profane nothing sacred ever again. Amen. Because he wants to give you more, but you've got to be faithful in those things which he's given you now so he can give you more. God is just as holy as he's ever been. And the holies of holies is just as sacred as it's ever been. But now he's allowed you and I to come in and behold him. But it's still just as sacred as it's ever been. In fact, the holies of holies have been moved to your heart. Hold up. His throne room moved to your heart. Jesus said in John 14, in that day you should know that the Father is in me and I'm in you. And if you obey me, my Father and I will come and make our dwelling with you. And out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. And I took John 14 and John chapter 7 and brought them together, but they needed to be. That the river that is seen in Ezekiel chapter 47 that is there coming forth from the temple of the living God, from right out of his throne room, is now coming right out of our heart. It's the Messianic age. God reigns right now. Right now. He's reigning right now. He's reigning right now. The darkness that Jesus was talking about there in John chapter 9, I must work while it's day because the dark's coming when no man can work. It was in the interval between the cross and the resurrection. You could apply it there, but that would be misapplied. He's talking about the time when there's no more grace for the Gentiles and no more grace for the nations. Now it's the wrath of God. It's the judgment of God, which the book of Revelation is all about. Where God begins to express how he feels about sin and iniquity, that he is literally the sin and the iniquity that you would allow and we would allow in our lives. How does he feel about it? Read the book of Revelation beginning in chapter 6. Ending in verse 20. I mean chapter 20. Beginning chapter 6, ending chapter 20. Somebody said recently to a friend of mine, a preacher's wife, oh, this is terrible. I can't even believe you're saying this. Revelation, the book of Revelation doesn't even apply anymore. It was destroyed at the cross. It's the mercy of God that did away with it all. Hold up, lady. Revelation was written after the cross. Like 90 years afterwards. No, not that many, 60, 65 years afterwards. No, it's still there. I thought we had no more judgment. There's judgment. I thought it was all finished. It is in heaven. It's going to be finished in you. Are you going to participate? He says, go wash in the pool of Siloah, which represents the water that flows from the throne of God. In fact, in John chapter 7, when Jesus said, if anybody thirst, come and ask me, and out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. It was at the moment of time when they went down to the pool of Siloam and drew water. He said, are you really thirsty? You really want the divine drink? Because it was related to the divine drink. It was related to the to Ezekiel 47 and the river, the spring that flowed out of the from underneath the threshold of the temple of God that then became a great river. And wherever the water touched, it healed the land. It brought forth fruit. It made the desert and the wilderness as a Garden of Eden. But the prophets always describe that. Everywhere that they describe that, they were describing it in terms of what God would do for us through the new creation, that our spiritual life would no longer be a wilderness, a desolate place, but it would become a place of the as a Garden of Eden, a place where God now walks and moves in, speaking of our attitudes and our passions and our emotions. I can't help it that Aristotle and Socrates said that the passions and emotions were evil. God never said so. They said it was innately evil. What's innately evil in unredeemed men? But redeemed men, we have God's passion and God's emotions. We got holy emotions and God's holy passions. Learn how to exercise in the things of the Spirit. Oh, now this is getting spiritual now. This is getting really edgy. Now he's doing some kind of language thing up there. I don't know what's going on. One person said, man, I've been in church so long, I forgot my Latin. This is in Latin. This is Holy Ghost. This is tongues interpretation of tongues. Interpretation of tongues in a meeting. We try to wait towards the end, a little bit hold back, a little bit so we don't freak everybody out at the beginning because no one realizes that tongues is a part of church service. They're so messed up. They want to sing with the understanding but not sing in the Spirit. Everybody can sing with the understanding but not everybody can sing in the Spirit. What? You're parsing things out that the Scripture never parsed out. Everybody can pray with understanding at the same time, but not everyone can pray with the Spirit. That's crazy. So the Bible doesn't say that. And so if you're going to have a rule for one, have a rule for the other. So now nobody can sing at the same time together. You sing, now you sing. You'd hate it that way. Those of you who have a good voice or you think you have a good voice, you'd like it, maybe. But the whole meeting would be taken up with just everybody getting to sing. Because by the time everybody gets to sing once, are you with me? That's never been so. It's ridiculous. It's silly. It's the doctrines of men to try to shut down the flow of this river, this glory. How about Riste? This thing that this divine expression of Pentecost. He says, go wash in the pool of Siloam. Go wash in that place that represents the wellspring of life, a spring coming up out of the innermost being. Huh? Because he's not going to only be healed of his physical blindness. He's going to be healed of his spiritual blindness. He's going to have to say, he's going to first say, well, Jesus is a prophet. Huh? That's where he's going to start. And but he's going to end up, you are the Son of God. Huh? Look at the conversion that takes place. First, he's got to go give a defense to his neighborhood. Is this the blind man? It looks like him, but it can't be. Oh, it's me. And then he rehearses what God did for him. I was just there begging, and this man came up to me named Jesus, and he took spit, and it was by his own initiative because there was no faith on my part even involved in this thing, just like there was no faith on the part of the lame man at the pool of Siloam. It was no faith on his part. It was just a messianic age. He will cause the lame to leap like the deer. He will cause the blind to see. It's just the messianic age. It's the reign of Christ Jesus. It's this new age of grace. He said, and you know what? I don't even believe that man going to the pool of Siloam was an act of faith. He just needed to get cleaned. It was probably the nearby water. And it was. It wasn't far from where he was at. I don't know, maybe there was a couple of buckets elsewhere, but I'm sure there was people who were leading him there just wanting to see what's going to happen now. His motivation was, I got mud and spit in my eye. I've been made unclean with mud and spit, dirt and spit, make you unclean. Leviticus says that it makes you unclean. That you become unclean until the evening if someone spits on you. Now he's got spit and dirt. Now he's got spit and dirt mixed together, put in his eye. He goes to the pool of Siloam. Now he's got to, he rehearses this with the neighbor. He's got to first go testify to his neighbors. And when I wash it, I can see. Amen. I pray that in every one of your life from this day forward, the spiritual reality of being able to see, yes, to where that you no longer are blinded by the spirits of darkness, where you no longer forgot what God did for you, where the spiritual reality of who you are and the relationship that you have with Him will be that which predominates everything that you think. Amen. Every action of your life. And I pray in the name of Jesus. Then he's got to rehearse it to the Pharisees, who then call in his parents, and it's an inquisition. And he goes through the same thing. And now they've run out of ways to discredit Jesus, to discredit the miracle. He's actually corrected their theology. A man who never was learned because he couldn't see, because he was cursed by God in their mind. He was cursed by God. Born blind, he's cursed. The curse of God is on him. They think they the blessing of God's on them. They said, if you say it one more time, we're going to excommunicate you. We're throwing you out of the synagogue. You'll no longer be a part of the Jewish community. He said, I'll say it again. He put mud in my eyes. He told me to go wash in the pool of Siloam. I did, and as soon as I washed, blindness fell from me, a scales from off my eyes. He didn't say that, but I just coupled that with what happened to the Apostle Paul. Saw when he was being baptized, when he was washing, after having an encounter with Jesus, blindness, spiritual blindness. He became physically blind that he might be able to spiritually see. And blindness fell off my eyes like scales. He took me from the cesspool of humanity and all of its dysfunctional, twisted realm in the blindness of the unregenerated nature. And he filled me with his love and his joy and his confidence and his boldness. He made me think right, live right, be right. Wow. Jesus, knowing that he was cast out just because he's telling people, look, I just had a miracle. I mean, give me a break. I just had a miracle. Pardon me for living. I just had a miracle. I'm sorry that my miracle offends you so desperately. Because that's religion. That's the state of men who will not be convinced no matter what you tell them. All they want to do is justify what they believe. It's just an argument. Don't ever open the Bible with people like that. You know? I mean, there is a certain point. Jesus said, he told a couple, he said, like, okay, you don't get this. So tell me this one thing. How did David, if David is his father, say, call him Lord? And they're just stumped. That's a good point. How did David, who was his father, call the Messiah, the one that would come, God Almighty? Not just sir, not just master, but God Almighty. So there's a certain place you can go, but you never argue. There's never supposed to be any arguing. There's never supposed to be any evil speaking. Anytime you speak evil of anyone, you're contaminating yourself. So that's why Paul said to the Philippians, let there be no evil speaking, let there be no grudging, let there be no arguments, that you may be the people of God, the light of the world, you know, shining in the midst of a perverse and crooked world. You're not in darkness, you're in light. You're not blinded anymore. You can see. Amen. Then Jesus, knowing he's kicked out, comes to him and says, do you believe in the Son of Man? What a way to say it. Obviously, he was familiar with the book of Ezekiel, because Ezekiel is the one who called the Messiah the Son of Man. He says, here's the response, the simplicity of it, the simplicity of salvation, the response. Who is he, sir, that I may believe in him? Huh? Come on, how hard is it to get right with God? Who is he, sir? This is the goodness of God that leads us to repentance. This is the grace of God. This is the mercy of God. This is the instantaneous power of the miracle. Who is he, sir? This is what every miracle, every sign and wonder is supposed to do for people. It's supposed to bring them to the revelation of who Christ Jesus is. Yeah. That's why the church can't be without it. That's why Paul called it the preaching of the fullness of the gospel. In Romans 15:19, I have preached the fullness of the gospel from Jerusalem to Illyricum with signs and wonders and a demonstration of the power of the Holy Ghost. I get to hold him for a little while because we're mentoring him. His name is Ezekiel. We're mentoring him to be a great prophet of God. He's consecrated, dedicated to the Lord to be a great prophet of God. We got another little man of God that was just born, John Samuel. And we You know, I can take people's babies and I can dedicate them under the after the fashion of Hannah bringing Samuel to the house of God, but I can't make their decisions for their house. Because many people come and they go through the activity, the ritual of supposedly dedicating their babies, which is only on the precedence of Hannah and Samuel, and they never give their children to the house of God. I mean, that's giving them over to the house of God. Samuel, as a little 4-year-old weaned kid, all he was doing every day was making sure that the candles were lit. He was learning how to do it. I don't think he was doing it for, but he was learning how to take care of the light in the house, how to minister to the sanctuary, how to clean out, you know, the candle trays, how to replenish and refuel the oil, how to take care, how to sweep out the holy place. The tabernacle was still at Shiloh. Shiloh. Amen. 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 I tell you right now, he's going to be more articulate here in a couple of years, I promise you. Hallelujah. We'll fill his vocabulary more than the rest of the stuff. Yes, it's true. It's true. I pray that you today, you would turn your life over. You would consecrate your life. Because there's no way that there is absolutely, you're becoming a major distraction. To me and everyone else. There's no way you're ever going to consecrate your kids to live this kind of a fashion and in this kind of a way. Say, I want my children to prophesy. Well, you have to lay hold on these things. Nobody can look at my house and say the favor of God's not on me and in my house. But I laid hold on that. No one can say that the results of the New Testament aren't visible and manifested in my house and in my kids. And by the help and the grace of God, they will be as ardently consecrated to God that in their children also, my grandchildren, will be only the ways of God.
Yes.
And the expressions of the Almighty.
Amen.
That takes something that doesn't really hold very true to the world and the spirit of the world called I'll do it my way, I'll have it my way. It's a place of coming under authority and being part of the ranks and the files of the armies of God. Hallelujah. Knowing those who have the rule over you, not in the realms after the arm of flesh is lords over your faith or, you know, but those who've just been anointed by God to speak His word and model signs and wonders and miracles. That's it. Huh? They can model what it looks like to follow Jesus, and you can see it. You look in their life, they go, wow, they're not only in, you know, it's like we don't even get some of the first principles. You know, people think that somehow that the Lord said that all the world was supposed to come to the church. He didn't say that. He said all the church was supposed to go to the world. Amen. Shiloh is come. To which the pool of Siloam, that word Siloam, is related to Shiloh. That which is sent of God. That place that springs up with the life of God. Shiloh, that's another name for the Messiah. I pray that you understand that if your life isn't wholly given over to God and consecrated to the Lord, there's no way your children will be. They'll sit in church and they'll play and they'll make distractions. My kids on the front row, I'm going to tell you right now, no matter what, it's okay for them to sleep. But there was zero tolerance for any misbehavior because they're learning how to behave themselves in the presence of the Almighty. Because these things are real. These are more real. My eyes have been open. I'm living. I see another realm. I see another world. I'm no longer blinded and compromised when I think that only the things that are going on in this natural landscape of things is the existence and what we're really supposed to be doing. No, I see the angels of the Lord. I see Jesus. I see this place, this realm called faith and divine authority. This interaction with the Almighty, this oneness with Him. Well, I want you to stand with me. Change your position. Hallelujah. 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 Be careful. Don't get too loud on me. I pray that, you guys got to be real careful with that. I pray that in the name of Jesus, that what has happened to you spiritually will become as effective, at least as effective, as what happened to the blind man physically. that you go tell your neighbors.
Amen.
That you'll be, well, fact of it is, I love it the way that God sets it up. They initiated the conversation. It's like, are you the same guy? No, I'm not. And then I'm different. He's like, yes, I am. I'm the guy. Well, you don't look like the guy. The guy that we knew was blind. You see, there should be that kind of a display of change in our life.
Yes. Amen.
Yes. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. The world is waiting to see. I mean, I told you, I think a couple weeks ago, about playing at golf with a bunch of guys who had these cigars that were like a foot in diameter, and I was trying to figure out how on earth they actually got that in their mouth. And you know, it got to a point where they all pulled the golf carts over and stopped, and it was a nice, beautiful place, beautiful scenery. I said, Lord Jesus, thank you so much for this day that you created. See, I get to just be me. I don't have to edit myself now. Just get to be. That's what I would do if no one was around. That's what I would do if everyone's around. Oh, Jesus, thank you so much for this wonderful day you made. All of them, some of them took their hats off and bowed their head. They're like, amen. You know, everybody's getting all sacred on me, okay? But what was going on at the same time is I know that the Holy Ghost was giving them an altar call. He was touching their lives. There's no way, you know, from that, you know, they were calling me doc and now they're calling me preacher. Fine. I got promoted. I got promoted. Listen, this life is an extraordinary life.
Amen.
This life that we've been brought into from blindness and darkness and death. It's extraordinary life. You need to start involving yourself with it. If you haven't discovered this extraordinary life, we want to help you in the name of Jesus from this day forward to begin to engage and interact with God in such a way that you really don't want anything else. This is an extraordinary life.
Amen.
He's brought to us everything that is good and wonderful. He brought to us everything that he himself in his love and his grace could supply. And all you and I need to do is agree with him. We have to agree with him. In Jesus' mighty name. Father, I thank you for the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Today, there's one more, the most important question that you possibly could be asked that you need to respond to him. Do you believe on the Son of Man?
Yes.
There's one most important question that every single person in this place needs to recognize that you got to deal with. Do you believe in the only begotten Son of God who came into this world for the purpose of dying for your sin? That you may have a entirely different existence. Not a human existence. A divine existence. I said not a human existence. Not a human existence. To be born again, to possess, to be a new creation, a new creature, is to have the divine nature, to live by the Spirit, to walk in the Spirit, to have God Almighty living on the inside of you. By definition, a divine existence. People run around saying, oh, the Lord just understands, you know, we're just human beings. You have been delivered from that state. You have been delivered from that excuse. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, God wants to give you revelation. He wants to open up your eyes. You're blind spiritually. You've been compromised. You've been blinded by the spirit of this world. And he wants to give you sight. He wants to, and for those of you that have seen, many of you maybe still are nearsighted. He wants to give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that the eyes of your understanding can be opened. And this is something that Paul addresses to a church, a people that have been born again and are alive from the dead spiritually. Who were once blind, but now they can see spiritually. And he says that your eyes can be opened. So that you can see what's going on, the benefits of heaven that are made available to you, the exceeding greatness of his power that is yours. That when you don't have enough food, you don't get concerned. You just say, multiply it, Lord. Some people that I know, they were doing a big meeting. There were several thousand people to feed. They didn't have enough food because it was in Africa. And so they just went with what Elijah did and what Jesus took to a whole other level. They prayed for the multiplication of the food. And the instruction that came from the Lord is just don't look in the pot. Every day they went in with the ladle. Bowl after bowl after bowl after bowl after bowl. One day it was beef. The next day it was chicken. Bowl after bowl after bowl after bowl. The conference went on for a little over a week. The senior mother, who was wife to the head overseer, looked in the pot. She couldn't have it. It was completely bone dry empty. No, miracles happen. Signs and wonders happen. The great works of the Lord Jesus Christ happen because somebody's eyes were open. And they could understand the exceeding greatness of His power that has been given to us. We're not talking about a defeat. We're not talking about being able to stand before the Lord with any justifiable excuse of why sin had more impact on your life than righteousness, why demonic influence had more impact on your life than the Holy Ghost. There are many people who have wrongly believed. What does it mean to believe on the Son of God, the Son of Man? They just think that, well, you know, well, I can continue on living my life the way I'm living, but now I don't have to go to hell. I get to go to heaven because I'm right with God, because now sin is no longer sin. Nonsense. Jesus is the way of escape from a demonic, sin-cursed world full of sickness and disease. If people are diseased, they really want the healing power of the Lord. They don't want to be diseased anymore. You have to understand that the state of sin is a disease. It's a spiritual disease. Not interacting with God and seeing and understanding and knowing these things about the fellowship that is made available to us is a spiritual state of blindness. And the beautiful thing is I don't tell you the bad things. I bring you the good news and say that God is the cure for you today. I don't care where you're at. I don't care whether you're blind and you cannot see, or whether you've been made to see spiritually, but you've never come to understand the beauty of the power and the authority that has been given to you, the life and the relationship that is yours. Today, let God have His way. Father is only going to respond to what you will. What you will, He will respond to what you will. He says, Lord, I just want to live in heaven from this day forward. Then I'm going to tell you right now, Father is going to respond with miracle power to Him. Enable you to live such a life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Today, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I pray that not one single person standing in this building, listening to me by the web, would refuse this wonderful opportunity to leave the realms of hell and step into heaven. Somebody said, what do you mean, read that leaves the realms of hell? We're still in earth. No, I'm telling you right now, it is a dimension of hell because it's filled with the activity of demon power. And upon sin, listen to me, this judgment has already come. The wages of sin is death. The judgment has already come. People have all the hell that they incur because they decided to participate with it, because the wages of sin is death. Sin will always result in more destruction, more upheaval, more turmoil, more broken relationships, more broken homes, more broken lives, more dysfunctional things perpetuated, propagated with interest in every generation. And Father just wants to give us the ability to see. Divine insight. Wisdom. Ability to see. All you have to do is yield yourself to the Holy Ghost, starting now. Have you ever noticed that God is allowed to do the most in your life when you're just thinking about Him? When the conversation is just about Him? Well, quit bringing all this other stuff into your life and convoluting things. Quit allowing all the other distractions. It gets better. Somebody said, how am I going to do my job? Better. How am I going to do the things that I'm responsible to do every day if I'm going to live like this? Better. You'll do them better. Thank you, Jesus. 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 When Christ Jesus comes into your life, He heals the heartache. He, He heals and cures the brokenness. When Christ Jesus comes into your life, He opens up the prisons that you've been bound by, that you've been contained in, liberates you so that you can enjoy what it means walking in this life in Christ Jesus. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that this day will be a day that begins a whole new dimension of living in Him for you. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In closing, I'm going to say this. There are people that are standing in right here right now. You're running the risk of hearing this and just going back and allowing the same things in your life to exist and justifying them. Now, you need to go home, clean house. No, I'm talking about you deciding if this day that you're no longer going to live the life that you've been living, but you're going to conform to the image of Christ Jesus, you're going to live His way. I'm talking about you willingly spiritually stepping out of your spiritual sickness, your spiritual disease, your spiritual blindness, and being so excited about it. Yeah. Somebody said, "Oh no, I gotta go live in health, and I've gotta go live in a place now where I can see perfectly all the beauty of God's creation, and oh, this is gonna be such a strain because now I can't live in all the turmoil and the torment." Because that really would be equivalent to somebody thinking that somehow their life is going to get all messed up if they consecrate themselves to Jesus, that they're going to miss out on all the fun. No, you're just going to miss out on all the blindness, all the sickness, all the disease, all the torment, all the harassment. Thank you, Jesus. Will you come? Will you hear the voice of the Lord Jesus Christ talking to you? Do you believe in the Son of Man? We just respond to Him and say, "Sir, who is He that I may believe?" I mean, if there's nothing else, if you're watching me by the web and there's no other response, "Sir, who is He?" And you would respond to Him with a sincere and true heart, not trying to seeking to justify whatever it is that you believe in the ideologies that you have. "Sir, who is He that I may believe?" I promise you, God in His mercy and His love will invade your life. If there's any people that need to get transparent, honest with God, it's those who visit His house every week. "Who is He that I may believe?" Jesus has just said, the person is talking to you. He reveals Himself. He wants to come reveal Himself to you. Will you let Him? Just lift your hands towards heaven right now. Just let Him. Just let Him touch you. Let Him overwhelm you with His goodness. Let a wellspring begin to spring on the inside of you. A wellspring will begin to spring and it will turn into a river. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. There's a wellspring for you right there. You can draw water from the well right now. The things that have tormented you and harassed you, God wants to heal you from them right now. He wants to heal you now, spiritually. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Just let Jesus touch you. Just let Jesus touch you. Let the power of the Holy Ghost overwhelm you. Let your wellspring spring. Some of you, I was saying, let your wellspring turn into a river. Some of you, I think we need to just get the wellspring going. Let me just encourage you that you are free to open up your mouth and begin to praise Him. Let me say this. It shouldn't be a hard thing to do. It really shouldn't be a struggle. Lord Jesus, I thank you, I praise you, I worship you. It's a wellspring. Thank you, mighty God. Thank you, mighty God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Father, thank you for the working of your mighty power right here at this very moment in every person's life. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I prava bakusanda ra ra beki ste preve beki atara ra lo mahamra ra beki ra ra masa prava va vala ra ra beti frats. Prava bakusambra ra beti andolo lo mahoko se preve hista. Oh, how glorious, how mighty. Father, we worship you. Lord Jesus, we worship you. We thank you, Father, for the wonderful works. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for this redemption. Lord, we thank you for the working of your mighty power in our lives. Oh, how wonderful. Thank you for this country. Thank you for this house. Thank you, Father, for the freedom that we have. Thank you, Father, for the blessings that you've given. Father, thank you that our name's written in the Lamb's Book of Heaven. Thank you that you washed us clean with your blood. Thank you, Lord, that you filled us with your Spirit. Thank you, Father, for the glory now, the outpouring of your Spirit, your signs, your wonders, your miracles, the working of your mighty power in our lives. Lord, we pray that the high praises will be in our mouth, that the rivers of your expressions will be in our hearts, oh God. Father, that everything about our life will be flooded with your presence, flooded with your glory. Hallelujah. Listen, the Lord wants you to get used to standing in His presence and experiencing His goodness. He wants you to get used to just being blessed by Him and overwhelmed by Him. Thank you, Lord Jesus. He wants to fill you right now with His joy and overwhelm you with His peace. And captivate you with His love. Come here, you got something to say? Come up here.
Psalms 22:3 says, God inhabits in the praises of His people. If you want your situation to change,
that's right.
If you want your circumstance to change,
that's right.
Then you've got to start praising, because in praise, there is joy. In praise, there is peace.
Come on.
And in praise, there is boldness that comes into you.
Yep.
In praise, there is a shout
yep.
That silences the voices of the devil.
Yep.
In praise, it's everything that you need
yep.
for the circumstance to change.
Yeah. You know how if you get all mad and upset, you get that breaking point, you start screaming and hollering, letting somebody know what you think? No. And you know how like you kind of like feel better after it's done? No, that's what happens to people in the natural realm. Like feel kind of some kind of a release. And that's purely demonic, as it were. But yet you still feel a bit better. You know what I'm saying? And I pray that you never feel that ever again, but nonetheless, I'm trying to make a point. It's the opposite. It literally is the opposite on the other side of the spectrum of what God wants to do through you when you begin to shout. Imagine if you dealt with your problems by literally shouting. No, listen, understand me. But begin to shouting unto the Lord within the framework of a desperation and a need for Him to intervene. That has, it's a shout, it is lifting the thing up before God, and it turns into a praise, and it turns into and the expressions that it's supposed to be of the Holy Ghost. I tell you, people, you find yourself breaking through everything that otherwise would hinder you and block you out of this flow of divine glory. I'm not talking about screaming out to God with frustration. I'm talking about lifting up your voice and crying unto Him. In the realms of faith. Saying, Lord, here I am. And it could be in this situation. And I pray that you don't have to do it here, especially if you're supposedly filled with the Holy Ghost. You could do it at home, so you can bring your best here to God. I pray that God doesn't have to clean house on you when you come to His house. That your house is clean and you can come and be what God's purpose for you to be in His house, so that other people can be touched and reached. But listen, understand. You begin to lift up your voice in a realm of faith and confidence and need. I mean, when the disciples are rowing across the sea, the lake, forgive me, and they spent almost 8-9 hours rowing, and the wind and the wave were contrary to them, there was a crying out to God. There was a crying out to God in the situation of their need, but it was the context of faith as they understood it. They didn't realize it, but they had faith to say that they had already been given the power and the ability to say to the wind and the wave, be still, but they didn't get it. Another sermon, another topic, another moment of point of discussion. It's just high time that we quit hearing sermons and don't do anything with it. You know, I'm going to dismiss, but we shouldn't. And I'm going to tell you why. We should actually wait until everybody steps into Pentecost, because that's what church is. It's supposed to be. Till everybody steps into a realm of flow where heaven's just flowing out of you. Praise is flowing. I can't even shut you down. It's just flowing out of you. The rapture of His glory and the rapture of His presence has you over in happy land, praise land, shout land, rejoice land. But what we're going to do, I'm going to let you go and practice this. So you can come back to His house and not just sing songs that somebody else wrote. And not just to express praises, you know, that you can produce. Begin to let the Holy Ghost take control where there's a love and affection and relationship going on that just causes you to be raptured, causes you to be captivated with heaven. And it is not a strain. A lot of times we just start praise and it looks like that they're repenting. It looks like they're going through a process of getting right with God so that they can now go ahead and be happy with Him. I want to ask you this one more time. I want to ask you to raise your hands towards heaven. And I'm believing God now in the name of Jesus that there are many people that are standing in right here right now that your eyes are going to be open and you're not going to just see the head of the person in front of you. You're not going to see any longer the realms of limitation that your physical being and your physical existence and your circumstances restrain you in. But you're going to now begin to interact with God in the realms of the Spirit. And heaven's going to be... Listen, and heaven will be able to break forth from your soul. Heaven will be able to break forth from your soul. Heaven will be able to break forth from your lips. I know some of you are quiet and you're sweet and you're not assuming and you diligently give yourself to prayer and to the study of the Word and you love the Lord with all your heart, but you've never really let the wellspring turn into a river of praise. Occasionally, for 5 or 10 minutes. But I'm going to tell you right now, you're missing out on something that you don't want to be missing out on. You're missing out on a realm of divine glory that is yours. It's available to you. God's not going to force you to have it. Preachers like me that know about the realm, we get a little bit frustrated and aggravated that people who need it don't know how to access it. But you just got to let it go. You just have to let it go. My mama used to say all the time, son, you can bring a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. You know, I'm like, oh, yeah, I can. What's this? Just learn that mama's right. Before you leave here, let every shame, let every guilt, let every condemnation be broken off of your life so that you can be free to pray. Someone said, how can I have that? The blood of Jesus Christ washes and cleanses. He doesn't need it. You don't need to have communion first. That only testifies of what he did. If you make the table the event, then you've disqualified the blood at the cross. You have to understand that. If you make the table the event, you've disqualified the event, the cross. And your faith is not upon him. It's upon another object. You hear me? Isn't it? You let the shame and the guilt and the problems and the circumstances and the things that cause you disappointment, you let them be washed away. You let them be removed. In Jesus' name. And if there's anybody here, you want me to pray with you and for you about anything, whether it's physical or spiritual, I'm here to do that. That's my job assignment, to get you into a place where you can also do that. But don't live your life another day in disappointment. Don't live your life another day without the wellspring being there, and especially without the wellspring being turned into a river, because you're missing out on the good stuff. Don't miss out another day on what it means to be filled with the Spirit, speaking yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual song, having these things activated and expressed through your life with extraordinary praise by the Holy Ghost. Don't live another day without letting the Word of Christ dwell in you richly, because of the same impact and the same effect will come. In Jesus' name. So I'm going to ask you to do kind of several things at the same time here. And that is, I want you to get ready to come. If you have any need you want us to pray for, I want you to get ready to come. I want you to come also with an offering to the Lord. Just those of you that are part of this church, those of you who are consecrated to the Lord, you know, worshiping the Lord with tithe and offering is absolutely essential. It's absolutely essential. You want to do that. Here, bring him here. I help him. He's calling out for me. And I want you to find a bunch of people around you. Hug them. Tell them that you love them. Bless them in Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Si carroba bobo si fredinanda da ramando da bocura si pita la donda da baharama. Si defre de chistere de veste prevetando da bolocca si sitela. Me membre veveve chitando da de veste prevebeca la nostra. I membre veve chiando da la bassembre veveve chiste titando da da bossu sotto rama ma macande de disti. Jesus. Lord Jesus. Bambrava da cliele da bushambra da 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 cliele da bushambra da da da. So membre bebe kia te do no 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 so tandist. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Anybody want prayer for anything? We're here to pray with you and for you, the Lord to touch you. Be confident of it. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Write down the name of Jesus, whatever you need of. Power of God comes upon you. Power of God overwhelms you right now. Touched with divine provision. Sabrabakatu tararabasistik itisht. Touched. Whatever you have need of, receive right now. It's yours. God supplies it by the Holy Ghost. God supplies it by the Holy Ghost. What do you need?
I want my
lost pain to flow and turn into a river, and
I want no spiritual
blindness
in my life. I want.
Lift up your voice.
Just lift up your voice and begin. Lift up your voice.
Lord Jesus.
You lift up your voice. Father's already given it to you. These things are yours.
Whatever you have need of, God supplies it to you right now in Jesus' name. Right now by the Spirit. Yours. Right now. Yours. Heaven's yours right now. Listen, heaven's yours right now. People, heaven's yours right now. Heaven's yours right now. Heaven's yours right now. Heaven's yours right now. Enjoy. Heaven's yours right now. Heaven's yours right now. Receive. Kingdom brought on Sunday the best. It did brought my most of Redneki. From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. Heaven's yours. It's yours. It's yours. It's yours. Right now in the name of Jesus. Receive. Just open up your mouth and begin to speak to him. Open up your mouth and begin to praise him. Open up your mouth and begin to express out of your heart how you feel about God. And then as you do that, God the Holy Spirit will hook up with you and he'll begin to express how he feels about God.
Amen. Hallelujah.
God will begin to express how he feels about God through you. The Holy Ghost will begin to express to you how he feels about Jesus. Hallelujah. Just go ahead and do it. From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. Thank you, Lord, for the anointing of the Holy Ghost. The invitation by the Lord is simply this. Would you like to live a heavenly life? Would you like to have a heavenly existence? So he says, receive from the new birth to divine provision that he brings to us and supplies to us continually by the Holy Ghost, even under the baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire. It's just all about living a heavenly life. Would you like to live in heaven now? There are people committing suicide because their life is so bad they want to... You know, I had a person actually so deceived that said, well, I'm going to commit suicide because I can go to heaven. Well, first of all, you're not going to go to heaven. And more importantly, all you got to do is quit being disobedient and stubborn and you can have heaven now. All you got to do is just let God have his way and conform to those things which he says. And you can have heaven right now. Sometimes it seems that people feel like that God's got to do a special work of grace for them to be able to experience what he did 2,000 years ago. God doesn't have to do an special work of grace. I'm also say this. Some of you look a whole lot happier hugging people than you were in the meeting a few minutes ago. Interacting with God the Holy Ghost. So the meeting is supposed to be about you hugging Jesus, hugging the Holy Ghost. Intimately interacting with him. And I promise you, I did not see this many smiles. And this many happy people. And I don't know what the issue is, but you want to get over it. You want to get out of your condemnation and shame. You want to get out of... You know, that whatever it is that's going on in your life, and let the wellspring turn into a river.
Yes, hallelujah.
Just let the wellspring spring. I mean, go ahead, continue to interact with each other. You look so much better. Right now in Jesus' name. Change. Become brasutolo lo most. I prestetist. From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. Now, in the name of Jesus, every sickness and every disease has to leave your body right now. And furthermore, you're going to be able to yield to the Holy Ghost and just flow in joy and celebration. Hallelujah. Just by the interaction of you with the Holy Spirit. There doesn't even need to be anybody lay hands on you. You're just going to be able to yield to the working of the Spirit of the Lord. Like never before, in Jesus' name. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. Well, you know what? You can either get what you want right now, or you can just be in doubt and unbelief and stay just as you are. But faith is going to lay hold on what Father has. Faith lays hold on what Father has, first and foremost, by receiving what the Holy Spirit is supplying. You have to yield to Him. Situations and circumstances will actually imprison you, because you will yield to that, and it will affect your attitudes and your emotions and your thinking. Finances do that to people. Relationships do that to people. To where whatever is most important to you and what you believe is going to make the difference to whether or not you feel good, have provision, etc., can literally imprison you. So the Lord wants to show you how to turn to Him right now, see Him, be captivated by Him, so the Spirit of the Lord can now, with all these other things, become meaningless. They're not even important anymore. Somebody says, can it actually be that finances won't even become important to me anymore? Yes. At that moment in time, God could really supply all that you have need of according to His riches and glory. Can relationships literally become demoted to where the Father is more important, the glory of that which He's doing in my life and wants to do in my life becomes more important, more influential? Yeah. It's the choice of our own wills. So, Faith, what do you have need of? What do you want? What do you want God to do? Why are you standing here? You have? How long has it been going on?
3 weeks.
So tell me again, because I think I heard what you said, but I'm in disbelief.
I've been having ulcer pains and stuff.
Will you have them no more? In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, you healed right now. Now, let's let Thanksgiving well up on the inside of you. You need Thanksgiving, confidence and faith. What's happening with you? What's going on? What's happening with you?
Yes, Lord. Praise God. I'm believing God. I'm out for my new place, and it is closer to the church.
Okay.
It's right across the street.
Okay.
From the church.
Okay.
They're making a decision this week, actually, tomorrow.
Well, in the name of Jesus, Father, I ask you to give your daughter favor right now.
Yes.
Give her favor and give her a smile that goes along with it and a confidence that goes along with it.
Yeah, it's for me. It's for me and Jonathan.
Okay. Okay. Well, good. Well, the Lord wants to give you favor, and He wants you to look like you have favor. I mean, I'll tell you right now, it really impacts you if you walk around feeling like you're the most special person on earth. It impacts you. You know, one of the things that's hard to deal with really wealthy people, if you've known really wealthy people, is they're just so overconfident, and they're so overconfident because of their wealth. They are in the category in their mind of exquisitely special. And it has a lot of bad repercussions. But how about when God's people embrace the wealth that he has given to us and our confidence in the Lord, and we become categorically the most special people. And it has good repercussions. You're not going to walk around feeling bad about yourself. You get rid of guilt and condemnation and shame, and you're going to have signs and wonders and miracles. I promise you in Jesus' name. Now, from this day forward, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, Father makes a way. Father makes a way so that you can live the change that Father has given. He makes a way. He makes a way for you. He makes a way for you. Sudarena eslembo brasatana. He makes a way for you. To be unaffected by anything that belongs to an earthly realm, to be unaffected by anything that men can do, and to be captivated by what's going on in heaven, and yield yourself to what God is doing, so that all the things that belong to this wonderful redemption, this wonderful realm of faith and by the things of the Spirit, you can have confidence in, function in, live in. Oh, when people are captivated that they can take a few loaves and fishes and turn them into a supply to feed the multitudes, because Jesus did it and empowered them to do it. So everything that you predict about your life and your future is all based upon the miraculous realm that is shown to us and demonstrated and modeled in the Scripture. Everything now begins to take on a whole new dimension of glory and splendor. People see a light and the life. Instead of just hearing you give a little story about what it is that you believe that makes no more difference in religious impact than Buddhism or Hinduism or Islam or Judaism, because it's powerless. It's word without power. It's word without demonstration. And you decide whether or not you're going to have this flow. And the first evidence of it is praise will begin. The first evidence is the shout will come. Hallelujah. They bombed out rasete. Malenga lechte parahaya. Mamblande exhalete resusta. Mananda eteli nonaku rasata de kaya. Habalana nea hitonga lechte. Because Father supplied it, He's brought it. It's yours. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Everything about your life from this day forward in the name of Jesus changes. It changes. It takes on the dimensions of faith and authority and power in Him, because you're not looking to yourself or looking at what's going on around you anymore, but you see a direct connection to heaven and a supply that's coming to you by the very power of the living God. You become special. Hallelujah. In your own eyes as He is in, as you are in His eyes. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, living God. Thank you, living God. I want you guys to go home and practice praising.
Amen.
I want you to go home, practice shouting and dancing and worshiping, so that you can begin to give yourself over. Just begin to give dando rabasast. Abramamanosa. You begin to give yourself over to the flow of the Holy Ghost, the flow of the Spirit. So do it. In Jesus' name. Don't just say amen, you got to do it. You say amen, you say I agree. That doesn't mean you're going to do it. You got to go from amen to faith, which has a whole bunch of obedience in it. Amen. So get prepared. Tonight, bring your dance, bring your praise, bring your shout, bring your worship. Bring your best. Evangelist Tim Hall will be with us on Wednesday night. And then you don't have to clap about that. It's an act of worship, praise. And you can thank the Lord for it. Especially, there's a couple of things I could say about that. But nonetheless, then Friday night we're going to have School of the Spirit. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, I pray that you go out with joy so that the mountain and the hills can break forth into singing. Huh? Hallelujah. Don't go out with joy. No mountains and hills breaking forth into singing. Jesus.
We love all of you. Bless you.